This program is sponsored by Dave Stahl.
It's time to get educated on your Second Amendment right. It's time to get locked and loaded with two full hours of Gun Sports Radio. Your hosts, Dave Stahl, Lance Pelkey, and Michael Schwartz will teach you anything and everything there is to know about firearms, self-defense, and the laws that affect your American right to own and bear arms. Visit GunSportsRadio.com with your questions and comments or to learn how to become a sponsor and or guest of the show. Now, here's your hosts, Dave, Lance, and Michael.
All right, folks, welcome to FM 96.1 AM 1170.
The Answer.
And by the way, before we get started, a very, very, very happy birthday to Laura Schwartz.
Oh, she's listening right now.
Happy 22 birthday. 22 years old and she's rolling down the highway. Hope she's having a wonderful day. She's probably still at the beach knowing that girl. She was looking pretty happy over there.
Yeah.
All right. Hey, folks, don't forget you can look for all our shows on any of your podcast platforms. Simple. GunSportsRadio.com. That's GunSportsRadio.com. And don't forget, it's a two-hour show. So if you were listening to this one, don't forget the second hour. But this hour is brought to you by Firearms Legal Protection. These guys are great friends of ours, and boy, do they do a great job. Firearms Legal Protection is the best legal protection for self-defense. Check them out on their website to see why at firearmslegal.com. Hey, do you need to take a CCW class? Well, you probably ought to think about it. For either San Diego or maybe Arizona, Florida, or other multi-state, CCW, well, visit ccwusa.com. That's ccwusa.com. They offer small class sizes, expert instruction to fit your schedule and your wallet. Three classes every month, two weekend classes, and starting at 8 a.m. Classes fill up quickly, so you better book as soon as possible. Private lessons are available, too. Great dates and times to meet your busy schedule. Check their website for details on how to apply for your San Diego or other multi-state CCW at ccwusa.com. That's ccwusa.com. All right. Well, GunProm got rained out.
No, that's not accurate. No. Here, in fact, let's talk about just a couple things real quick right off the bat. So this coming up week is normally when San Diego has their monthly meeting and when San Bernardino has their monthly meeting. And those, due to the coronavirus panic, right, have been canceled. The meeting's been canceled.
Yeah.
You know, everybody's mind is somewhere else, so we figured, hey, why do the whole thing? We want these meetings to be productive. We want them to be useful. So if everybody's mind is somewhere else and half the folks are concerned with the coronavirus and they're not going to show up, then we're
looking for toilet paper.
We're looking for toilet paper, taking care of loved ones, doing all the things that really, right, you know, they need to do. Orange County's dinner on the 28th is postponed. So if you have tickets to that, just hold on. We will honor any refunds, but we're going to see what we can do about, you know, just getting a different date and rolling it into a little bit later this year after this all clears up.
Yeah, we just have to wait and see how this pandemic rolls out and where we're going with it.
Right. San Diego County's Second Amendment celebration dinner, gun prom on May 16th. Nothing has changed. That's still months away. Everybody, you know, just sit tight. We're going to continue rolling with that. Riverside's meeting is also on the 28th of this month. That has not been canceled yet. Mm-hmm. So we're going to play this day by day. But I just wanted to get some of that out there and let everybody know.
Appreciate it. I think that's important.
Well, this has been a pretty good. Go ahead.
I was just going to say, San Bernardino on Wednesday is actually having a Facebook live event rather than a meeting. So just tune into that. Lauren's doing a great job.
A lot of the gun shops have had runs on their guns and on their ammo and stuff like that. And Dave and all of us, we've been saying since day one to do what? You know,
gear up,
buy ammo and in advance of all this stuff. And here we are.
But I got to tell you, folks, it's so crazy out there that Casey's not going to be able to call in today.
Yeah.
Because the gun range San Diego is wall to wall with people.
Yeah.
Well, I was there on Friday, actually, and it really was a steady stream.
Yeah.
Well, it really was. There were people, we were talking about it before. Joe and I were just talking about it. There were new gun owners looking for a gun. There were experienced gun owners looking for ammo, looking for another gun. It's pretty steady.
Well, and Brandon says, you know, what's the worst job right now, you know, ever? And that is, what's the worst job?
a sports commentator or a sports talk show host.
Yeah, that's a work because there's no sports. There's nothing to talk about. You can't talk about nothing. It's just gone sideways.
They should be looking at the paid vacation aspect of that.
You think?
Oh, yeah. It'll blow over in a couple of weeks. So
my wife's pretty excited. She's hoping when she goes in Monday, they're going to turn around and send her home because she can work from home. So,
it's a good time to do the shooting sports. You know, go out to your range or BLM or whatever the case may be.
That's even better.
And practice up, be 6 feet from each other. That's normal.
Or 10 if you want.
Sure.
Out in the desert at a designated shooting area. That's
designated
social distancing right there, right?
Hey, and and the off-road community already went out and cleaned up the area, so it should be cool.
Yeah.
Time to use them.
Yeah. Well, and if we're talking a little bit about it, the main thing with this coronavirus is just use your head. Use your head. Wash your hands. Cough into your arm. And just, if you're not feeling well, don't even go out. Stay home.
Yeah, all the stuff you would normally do during the flu season, which we do every year. Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah, and maybe a little bit of heightened if you know people that have compromised immune systems, they're older, whatever the case may be. Why take the chance to get them sick?
Well, no, I agree.
It's the same thing, though. I mean, my mother-in-law is 86. My mom's 86. They don't want the flu either. It's bad for them, too.
My father-in-law tells me today, as I'm getting ready to come to radio, they're coming to go to the gym. I go, you're going
good for him.
I'm going to go to the gym. No, you're not going to the gym. You don't know how clean the gym is. You don't know. No, that's a.
Well, it drives me nuts. I grew up in Florida where every season we had two or three hurricanes, like clockwork. And, it was the same thing every time. The grocery stores, lines out the door. And I just can't believe it. I mean, you don't have to be some
interesting
kooky prepper.
Isn't
your cupboards, to be prepared.
Aren't you prepared?
We're prepared.
Aren't you prepared?
I'm prepared.
Aren't you prepared?
I am. I'm good for a month.
And I've been and I've been prepared before this.
I don't understand. If you live in an earthquake zone, I mean, you better have ammo. You better have
flashlight batteries.
Yeah, batteries and beans
and water.
Water. And I mean, it just makes sense. I just don't understand.
It's just a great time to buy Spam.
If you're my wife, every day is a great. She loves Spam.
Does she really?
Oh, my gosh.
So do I.
I don't know what's wrong with her.
I cook it every way possible, too. And I'm telling you. And I've got some newskis in there, too, though. I just thought I'd let you know.
But little newskis?
Got about four in the freezer.
How can you say Spam and newskis in the same sentence? Oh, my gosh.
No.
It's sacrilege.
That sounds great. A newski Spam sandwich. I may have to check that thing out. But no, all seriousness aside, folks, we're just as concerned as everybody else is. It's just that, come on, be serious. We just can't go crazy over it. Just be smart.
Then again, if you're a responsible adult, you should have 30 days worth of stuff. What I didn't think, I've got food, I've got water. I didn't think about the toilet paper, though. So I'm going to use that as a learning experience here.
Well, the newspaper, they just print five extra pages with no print on it for you.
Certainly improvise, but.
Well, I have to admit, I went to the grocery store last Thursday because we needed paper towels, for the puppies, So I'm walking through.
Boy.
And my cashier, who I know really well, she is so frazzled, man. It looked like, because the lines were all the way to the back.
Right.
And I says, good, I just bought paper towels. That way I'll just cut them in thirds.
There.
So I won't have to come back.
There you go. Or, hey, this is a perfect time to renew your subscription to the Union Tribune.
Yeah.
Finally, it's good for something.
No. Do you know how much that costs? My father-in-law told me it's $115 a month to subscribe to the UT.
A month?
Oh, never mind.
A month.
All right. Toilet paper is a lot cheaper.
Yeah, toilet paper is, or there's plenty of bushes outside, leaves.
Yeah, of course. I was corn. A Boy Scout.
Everybody loves corn cobs, right? Corn, eat the corn, keep the cob.
I'm going to pretend I didn't hear that.
Well, let's try to raise the conversation a bit here, but you mentioned the puppies, and that's something else people don't think about. I got 30 days food for us,
same
but
thing
30
with
days
us.
For the dogs, because dogs have to eat, too, if something happens.
We just went in last week and got 5 40-pound bags. But you haven't seen our dogs eat. So I told my wife, I says, you need to, well, it turns out a lady who just got a puppy from us, the little sponge puppy, works at Costco.
Oh, okay.
So I just told her, I said, give her some money, have her pick up bags, and then that way we won't have to go try to get in line or do any of that.
That's a good idea.
Yeah, that's kind of what I thought, too.
Well, it's not about being prepared. Washing your hands, making sure to cover your mouth.
Now,
you know, having
you wash
some
your
food.
Hands more now than you did before.
Honestly, I really don't think I do. No, I mean, I wash my hands. Just be a responsible adult.
Do you avoid
every time before I come in the house or when I come in the house, I wash hands from coming outside.
I was going to say, do you avoid people that are hacking and retching and gagging in the corner
every day for the last 40 years of my life? You know, I just look. Nobody wants to get the flu. I'm certainly not minimizing this, but what drives me crazy is that they're having to remind people to be responsible adults. None of this is, you know, brain surgery.
I know. And then, what are we going to do about the homeless? Because nobody's really doing anything about the homeless. And if it ever gets into the homeless community, it's over.
Well, it might be what they need to just enact like a martial law and do something about the problem in general.
Yeah.
This might be what it takes.
Did you hear Newsom? I caught word that he wants everybody 65 and older to stay home. Close all the bars, close all the restaurants.
Well, the problem with that is I'm not over 65. What if I want to eat at a restaurant?
Yeah, I know.
You know what I mean?
I know.
So if you're over 65, I think that you should take your own, you know, responsibility in your own hands.
Exactly.
And say, hey, you know what? I'm over 65. I have a respiratory problem anyway. I'm going to stay at home.
Yeah.
I'm going to wash. If somebody comes over to my house, I'm going to make sure that they wash. I mean, all this stuff is, like I said, I don't understand why we have to be.
Well, I think it's like the helmet law, because I wasn't for the helmet law. I just said, look, as long as you have insurance and you bash your brains in and you got the insurance to pay for it, go ahead.
Yeah.
So if the guy's 65 years old and wants to go out and do his thing and he wants a respirator, tell him to hell with you. Because, you know, we told you. And so you took a chance.
Yeah. So I know I'm right there.
You don't get a respirator.
No.
Anyway.
Let's take a break.
Oh,
right.
You're on it.
Yeah, we're done with that. Now we're going to get into the real...
Let's talk about guns.
Nuts. Yeah, let's talk guns. Let's talk ammo. Let's just talk about anything other than right here on FM 96.1, AM 1170.
The Answer. The Answer.
All right. What's the best defense for self-defense in those horrible new red flag laws? Well, that's firearms legal protection. Mike, Lance, Joe, and I use them. Firearms legal protection is a legal defense program for lawful gun owners with a 24/7 emergency hotline and plans designed specifically for the firearms owner. Talk to the good folks at Firearms Legal Protection today. That's Firearms Legal Protection at firearmslegal.com. Call them at 469-310-9100, 469-310-9100. Gun owners, be ready with a lawyer in your corner. California assault weapon laws make it almost impossible to own an AR pattern rifle. What's the solution? Tally Key. Converts any mil-spec direct impingement AR platform rifle into a straight pull bolt-action rifle so it can have all the features without being considered an assault weapon. It's a true drop-in solution, no milling, no aesthetic modifications, and no turning off your gas system. Keep your entire AR collection intact at a price you can afford with Tally Key. Check out Tally Key at tallykey.com, K-A-L-I-K-E-Y.com. Holy mackerel, if you thought the refi bell just went off this week, well, let me tell you, it is rocking. Home mortgage interest rates have dropped to a historic low. And if you're looking to buy or refi, or if you're considering a reverse mortgage, call our local mortgage guy that you can trust. Call Chris Wiley at PRMI Mortgage for nearly 25 years. Chris has been helping local San Diegans with all of their mortgage needs. Call Chris Wiley at 619-722-1303. That's 619-722-1303. Or go to primeres.com/Alpine. All right, Mr. Schwartz, who have you got as our special guest today?
Very special guest. Dan Gross used to be the president of the Brady Organization, and he's got a new project and working with some new folks. And so I wanted to have him on to talk a little bit about it. Dan, are you there?
I am, Michael. Hi.
Hi, Dan. How are you?
I'm well, thanks. How are you?
Good. So you were, I believe, back in somewhere around 2012, you were the president of the Brady Organization, correct?
Yeah, 2012 to 2018.
And what got you there? What got you involved in the Brady Organization?
Well, you know, I got involved in, you know, issues related to guns after, you know, unfortunately, like a lot of people, I experienced a tragedy in my family where my my younger brother, Matt, was shot in a mass shooting that happened on the observation deck of the Empire State Building. He was shot in the head, critically injured. And all things considered, you know, he's doing great. He's alive. And, you know, not a lot of people suffer as grievous an injury as that and live to talk about it. So, you know, I have a brother, my kids have an uncle, but it's certainly changed his life forever. And in my case, it changed what I wanted to focus on in my career. At the time, I was a partner at a big ad agency at JWT, J. Walter Thompson at the time, and just found that I couldn't go back to work, realizing that, you know, there was an opportunity to hopefully try and do something about something that impacted my family so directly. So I started an organization that was called the Center to Prevent Youth Violence that is decidedly non-political, didn't at all get involved with any advocacy. And as we'll discuss, I've kind of come full circle back to that. But over time, that led me to ultimately become president of the Brady campaign. You know, I just had all the respect and admiration for Jim and Sarah Brady and what they did, and wound up doing that for a number of years, but wound up leaving in 2018, and now I'm working on the project that you referenced before. Yep. something new with some new folks that we're super excited about.
So let's talk about what were some of the reasons that you left the Brady Organization?
You know, I can't talk specifically about you know, anything related to Brady and to my departure, but I can talk generally about you know, some of the frustrations that I had focusing on kind of the political debate and the ideology that I've always believed exists on both sides of the equation. You know, I think the people on the gun control side are very quick to accuse the other side of coming from this place of pure ideology and not having their hearts in the right place in terms of really preventing tragedies. I've always tried to have a lot more empathy in that conversation. And, you know, and I actually found a lot of the conversations that I wound up having with people who thought they agreed with me to be the most frustrating conversations.
So when you were going into the Brady Organization, what was your goal? What were you looking to accomplish?
So, you know, I've always approached the issue of, you know, when you call gun violence prevention, gun safety, whatever you want to call it. I always approached it from a perspective of empathy. Like I always thought about advertising. You know, you have to really try and, if you want to change things, you have to really try and understand where everybody's coming from on every side of the issue. And I felt like there was an opportunity to refocus the Brady campaign that, you know, at the time I had felt was losing a little bit of their focus as an organization in a way that really was empathetic to people who own guns and who make the choice to own guns. And you can see there are a lot of places where I'm on record, including in my TED talk, where, you know, I talk about the fact that the average person who owns a gun is like the average American, you know, a decent law-abiding person who cries when there are tragedies that happen. You know, and my dad might have taken me to Yankee games. I live in New York when I was a kid. And, you know, their fathers who take their kids hunting when they're, and it's just as meaningful and it's just as important.
So
I hope to introduce some of that into the work of the Brady campaign and into the work of the gun control side. And to, you know, talk about, you know, frame everything that we were doing in terms of our common goals, not, you know, a divisive argument.
Okay. So, and that's, I don't want to put words in your mouth, but I just to kind of paraphrase from what I've seen when I was, you know, reading more about you, is you were kind of trying to say, hey, look, let's do some meaningful work to make sure that firearms don't fall into the hands of dangerous people, and let's stop villainizing people just for being gun owners. Is that kind of a fair paraphrase?
completely fair. And, you know, one of the lines that I talked about the most was, you know, and to kind of sum up, even when I've always talked about the issue politically, you know, the conversation should not be about taking certain guns away from all people. It should be how we keep guns away from certain people and the people that we all agree shouldn't have them.
So I don't I don't feel like that perspective would fit in well at the Brady Organization, at least not the Brady Organization that I've been exposed to. Did you tend to bump up against others when you would say, hey, look, why are we villainizing gun owners? Why don't we concentrate on keeping, you know, firearms away from dangerous people? Would that conflict with other people at the Brady Organization?
Again, I don't want to talk about anything specifically as it relates to Brady, but more with what I would say is too many people on the, you know, on the gun control side of the equation. Yeah, I mean, it's very public that I took a lot of a lot of grief for some of the things that I, not the things that I wanted to prioritize. Obviously, nobody on the gun control side would have a problem with background checks. That I feel, you know, if we can figure out the right way to do it, would be a way to have a huge impact. But, you know, where there was a little bit more, or in some cases a lot more disagreement, and again, I'm talking just generally about the gun control side, was, you know, and this includes conversations that I had, you know, in with people in very high political office, where, you know, I didn't feel like a conversation around assault weapons ban should be prioritized. I think that's the, you know, that you know, first of all, wouldn't save as many lives as background checks has the potential to save. It's, again, that question of taking certain guns away from all people instead of the goal of just keeping guns out of dangerous hands. And it continues to make this a divisive debate, because, you know, the people on the, you know, from the gun community hear ban and think you want to take all their guns away. And it just makes it really difficult to have a platform like the one that I advocated about, let's just keep guns out of the wrong hands, and then out of the other side of your mouth, say, assault weapon ban.
Right.
So
well,
there was a lot of a lot of blowback that I got in general for that.
Well, I got to tell you, I mean, I run a Second Amendment organization, a political Second Amendment organization, pro Second Amendment organization, and by all accounts, we're extremely level-headed, extremely pragmatic, very nonpartisan, and appeal to a very broad group of people, which is something that makes sense because we're here in California, and it's a different environment than it would be in some other states, but we do a fairly good job. I still get attacked by Brady Organization and Moms Demand Action people. I get attacked personally. You know, I've had to put security on my house. It has times been very, very ugly. We've been forced to hire more security at events because of threats from them. It's really been really, really ugly. But okay, so you've moved on. You're doing something. You're partnering with Rob Pincus, who's somebody we interviewed a few weeks ago, who's an instructor, very pro Second Amendment. He's a firearms instructor, great guy. We've had him come to our events and talk. Tell us a little bit about. We got about 1 minute left. Tell us in a minute what you guys are looking to accomplish and what you're looking to do.
Center for Gun Rights and Responsibilities. It's very simple. With the right, unquestioned right to own a gun and to own guns comes the responsibility to make sure you do it as safely as possible. So we advocate the non-political solutions that center around education and awareness to empower every gun owner with what they can do to make sure that they can prevent negative outcomes with their firearms.
Excellent. And hey, tell us a little bit about, like, how are you looking to do that? Are you guys going to host seminars, or what's the nuts and bolts?
Yeah, so there are going to be a couple things. The biggest thing that we're going to be launching with, you know, everything is obviously in flux now with all the bigger things that we're addressing as a nation. But we're going to be launching with a pledge of responsible ownership called the Gun Pro Pledge of Responsible Ownership, Gun Pro Pledge, that is built on tenets that Rob Pincus has developed in his lifelong career as a firearms expert and instructor. that that we're gonna work to get a million gun owners across the country to sign, and they're gonna be able to sign it with witnesses who will vouch for that gun owner's responsibility, so that they to make sure that they take it with appropriate seriousness.
And where do people go for more information?
I mean, right now we're going to need to say stay tuned, because okay. we're launching our website, but I'd love to come back on when that pledge is out there, and we can give you more information.
Excellent. Well, thank you for coming on today, Dan. I really appreciate it.
Yes, sir.
Thanks for having me. I appreciate it. All right, bye bye.
All right, we're going to take a quick break. When we come back, a whole lot more right here on FM 96, what, AM 1170,
The Answer.
Folks, welcome back. You're listening to Gun Sports Radio, FM 96.1, AM 1170. The
answer.
Sleeping on the phone again.
Wow. That was, nah,
he's busy. Hey, folks, have you ever been to AO Sword Firearms in El Cajon? Oh, my goodness. It is an amazing place. They got the widest selection of guns in San Diego County, with over 600 unique guns in stock, including hundreds of used guns. Go see their full-service experienced gunsmith. They can do everything from mild repairs to full custom firearms. AO Sword Firearms store located at 929 East Main Street in the lovely city of El Cajon. Go to their website at aosword.com or call 619-749-4867. Build, buy, or repair. AO Sword Firearms is your go-to place for all things firearms. That's aosword.com or call 619-749-4867. That's 619-749-4867. The segment next is brought to you by Gatsky, Dillon & Balance, LLP. Go to cafirearmslaw.com if you have any gun issues from a legal standpoint. John is our resident lawyer, and boy, if nobody's on top of it more than John is. You can call him at 760-431-9501. That's 760-431-9501. John is a great asset when it comes to you, your guns, and the law. So
there he is. What'd you guys think of that interview?
I thought that, he went to work. I understand why he did what he did. But I think that when he took the job at the Brady Organization, if he did his investigation, that he would have saw that it would the funding. There's that organization we talked about on the show before called Act Blue. Act Blue runs under the guise that they fund grassroots organizations. But the real aim of Act Blue is to fund Moms Demand Action and all these other crazy extremist anti-gun groups. Mm-hmm. And he went to work for one of them. He knew exactly what he was doing. Maybe he hoped to change the
culture.
But you can't when they're that extreme. Good for him. He bailed.
I have a lot of people who ask me, like, hey, have you reached out to the other side? Have you talked to people on the other side?
That's right.
Have you talked to the leadership at the moms or whatever? I have in a couple of different situations, and one in particular is a guy named Ron who runs the Brady Organization. He helps out with Moms Demand Action. He and I sat down. This was maybe 3-4 years ago, and had lunch. And I said, hey, no agenda. Let's just sit down and chat. And we talked, and he had some of the same issues and problems that I have running an organization, you know, that we had some things in common.
Mm-hmm.
And we came up with we had a really reasonable conversation, I guess is what I'm trying to say. And, you know, things like, well, gee, you know, what if we increase the qualifications for a CCW, but then having a CCW, you don't have to worry about assault weapons bans, and you don't have to worry about, magazine limitations, all that other stuff. You know, you've gone through this background check, you've done all these things, just kind of spitballing, you know, and just seeing like, well, what's acceptable? What exactly are they trying to do? Mm-hmm. And he said, yeah, you know, and then basically making the CCW your golden ticket. You know, you get a CCW and then you don't have to worry about all these other crazy laws. And, oh, yeah. And I said, well, what about this gun show? I mean, you guys don't really want to ban the gun show. Oh, no. You guys are, you know, gun show's great, legal business, et cetera, et cetera. Then I see him just a couple years later protesting the gun show. I reached out to him and said, hey, they're trying to ban the gun show. How about you and I go down hand in hand, you know, and say, oh, no, this is not a solution. Nope, couldn't do that. Couldn't do that. And I think what happens is they get in front of members and volunteers who get all worked up and they can't back them down. You know, they can't say, hey, hey, look, we need to have a reasonable conversation. We need to take reasonable measures because the people that tend to get involved are kind of the fringe element, you know. So the fringe element comes in and says, oh, no, we don't want reasonable. We want total confiscation and total bans and that sort of thing. And they're stuck. You know, I either do what my membership says or I don't have a membership. And I think that that's the problem. I mean, in a nutshell, right? I mean, it could probably write a novel.
Well, you would know more than probably anybody in this room, like I said, but I agree with you. But my take on it goes back to the funding. And one of the planks of the Democrat Party is they in my opinion, it's gun confiscation. And so because of that, then if they're funding the Brady Organization, what are they going to do?
Right.
And so that's it. So and nothing against the good Democrats out there. That are the blue Democrats that believe in the Second Amendment. You know,
well, and it's not Democrats and Republicans.
It's true. Take a look at Act Blue. I'm telling you, all of you, take a look at Act Blue. And when you read the depth of what they do, they're the funding organization that's creating a lot of grief for us, in my opinion. They're very organized and they're creating, and it's a lot of money. And so what could we do? What could your organization do with a lot more money?
Right.
A lot more good.
Right.
Yeah.
Well,
but it was great having Dan on, though.
It was great having him on. And I'm glad he's doing what he's doing. There was one of the reasons I wanted to have him on is that Rob, who's a good guy, I think we've all.
He's Rob's super.
Super guy, has been taking flack on the internet for partnering with the Brady Organization. That's not what's going on. He's not partnering with the Brady Organization. A guy who walked away from the Brady Organization. I was a little disappointed with how vague the conversation was as far as why he walked away from the Brady Organization.
Well, I understand why he maybe didn't want to talk about specifics, so he spoke in general. But, you know, talking about this new organization that he's creating, when we had Pincus on talking with him, who is a super guy, my opinion on that still is here we are having reasonable conversations, logical conversations about all this. And the other side, there's no logic there. It's emotion. Plus, it's against the Second Amendment, but they've still been winning. So creating this organization in another logical organization to try and put logical answers in front of, emotional people, just don't know how far it's going to get. You know, you want 1 million signatures. Is that enough? 10 million? I mean, I think you brought up a very good point about if you had a CCW, then you could waive the high capacity limit and the assault ban and all that other stuff. And
well,
and
again, we were just spitballing.
No,
we
don't
have,
idea,
we just
though.
Got like, hey, but I was, what I was probing, I was it, probing to see like,
that
what,
was really
what are you
good.
Guys trying to accomplish?
That
here?
Was really, really good. And then, but at the end of the day, they'll still say no, because we know what their agenda is. So my opinion, my answer to them is no, hell no. So
well, I've gotten into the habit of asking reporters now because I get a lot of reporters who say, hey, what do you think of this law? What do you think of that law? And it's usually followed up with, what will you guys support? And I've turned it around and said, well, wait a minute. You've talked to the other side. What side or what law is too extreme for them? Have you asked them that? You know, at what point do they go, hey, no, this law is way too extreme? Because we're constantly having to compromise. You know?
Yeah, it's always our side.
Well, and what do we get back?
Well, and the problem is, though, when you compromise, that's why a lot of organizations now, NRA-type organizations and gun-owner organizations, don't want to compromise. Because every time you compromise, you know, 2 years later, the compromise now is a loophole that's killing children and old people, and it needs to be closed.
Which is true. And I think, again, we've talked about this before, but they changed the word so they control the agenda and they control the narrative. Mm-hmm. So we've lost the control of the narrative. We've lost control of the agenda because we're using their words once again.
Right.
Never use that word assault, you know, weapon, assault ban, high capacity, and that kind of thing, because that goes back to to them winning again.
Yeah, well, like Michael's saying, too, there's never a con. I mean, I don't remember ever hearing of a compromise on the other side. The other side saying, okay, well, all right, you guys did this, so maybe we can get rid of this other thing.
Well, just
you never hear that.
Never hear it. Just a couple years ago, Congress said, hey, we want to fix the National Instant Criminal Background Check.
Which they needed to do, yeah.
Yeah. You have a board member here for a, you know, a pro-Second Amendment organization who just said, yeah, they need to fix this.
They needed to, because on some of those, like the church shooting, that guy in Texas, one of the first church shootings, that guy was in trouble in the Air Force. They knew about it. He should have been in that system.
And they let him out.
It was a human error thing. Mm-hmm. They did not submit that information. And he didn't get picked up.
So we went in and said, yeah, you know what? If you're going to have this background check system, it needs to actually work. People need to be able to rely on it. So this is a gun law that we didn't, you know, that we said, yeah, all right, yeah, you know, do this thing. It passed. There's never been a law that the Brady Organization or Moms Demand Action, they've never come out and said, no, this goes way too far.
Right.
We don't support this level of restriction.
Well, they don't care. They just want to restrict.
Exactly.
That's all their agenda is, no matter what they tell you or no matter what they say.
Well, their rhetoric and their action, there's an enormous delta between their rhetoric and their action.
Well, and I think it's all based on the people that send them money to do what they're doing.
Yeah, they're funded by the bad guys.
It's all about money. So, you know, it's not about principle. It's not about safety. It's about money.
Which is what makes them an extremist organization.
Exactly. And folks, it is what it is. Black and white. Look it up.
It's true.
You know, you don't have to take our word for it. Just look it up. Because, you know, we try to give you the straight scoop. Give you the opportunity to make an intelligent decision, not an emotional decision.
And if you're out of town, you could still join San Diego County Gun Owners. Absolutely. If you're out of state, the fight is here. We're, you know, we've been joking. I've been joking when I say broadcasting from deep behind enemy lines, but it's no joke.
Yeah. Well, we just had a couple buy puppies from us. One's a Marine. The other one is his new bride. They both just started shooting.
Nice.
And I said, well, you got to hook up with San Diego County Gun Owners. It's $10 a month. He says, yeah. He says, I've heard about them. I said, you can't get a better deal. Get the wife involved. There's all kinds of socials. There's all kinds of opportunities. You just need to do it. So I gave him one of my cards.
It's the answer.
Cards.
We know what the problem is, but we need money. We need funding.
I just had my cable guy just he and his wife are looking to buy a firearm. And I said, well, you know, I was just curious. I said, where do you guys live? They live down in Chula Vista. Well, what's the catalyst? Why do you guys want to buy a firearm? He said, well, you know, it's a bad neighborhood. Weird things are happening. You know, we're starting to build a family.
Sure.
So they want to be able to protect themselves and their family. And I said, well, have you thought about a CCW? He said, absolutely. My wife's a nurse, and she absolutely wants to carry. And I thought, you know what? This is normal. This is what normal, reasonable people
do.
That's right.
And that's why they want what they want, because they are normal and reasonable. They just want to protect their family.
And especially the government is not funding law enforcement.
Nope.
Look at the response time we've talked about, the lack of response time, 15 minutes and the rest of that stuff.
Nope.
So
not good. All right, let's take a quick break right here on FM 96.1, AM 1170.
The Answer.
Folks, welcome back. You're listening to Gun Sports Radio, FM 96.1, AM 1170.
The Answer.
All right, folks. Hey, what's the best defense for self-defense in those horrible new red flag laws? Firearms legal protection. Mike Lance and I use them. Firearms legal protection is a legal defense program for lawful gun owners with a 24/7 emergency hotline and plans designed specifically for the firearms owner. Talk to the good folks at Firearms Legal Protection today. That's Firearms Legal Protection at firearmslegal.com. Call them at 469-310-9100. 469-310-9100. Gun owners, be ready with a lawyer in your corner. This segment brought to you by the Gun Range San Diego. It's the Nordstrom's and Gun Ranges, just not the price. All about service. 7853 Balboa Avenue in San Diego, 10 to 10, 7 days a week. TheGunRangeSanDiego.com. That is TheGunRangeSanDiego.com. All right, well, the crew went out to Frontsight last week.
Frontsight, Nevada. Frontsight Resorts in beautiful Pahrump.
Pahrump, Nevada. Poor Lance and I had to stay back and work. But so Joe and Mike and his lovely bride, Laura, all went out there and shot up the desert.
Yep, four-day pistol.
Yeah, four-day pistol. Do we have Laura on the line? All right, and a one, and a two. Happy birthday to you.
Faster.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Laura.
Happy birthday to you.
To you.
Thanks, okay. Guys.
Well, we knew you. Yeah, well, you deserve it. So how'd you like Frontsight?
Oh, I loved it so much. This year was my first year going for all 4 days.
Oh, wow. Grueling.
This is my third year. Last 2 years, I went for 2 days. Actually, the first time that Michael took me out there, he's like, look, I'll just take you for 2 days, and then I'll take you to Vegas. So he kind of tried to bribe me to go out there. And I had a great time, but this year was going to be my first 4 day. And he even told me, he said, okay, on the third day, it's going to be a lot of drills and stuff. And so I thought, okay. And I was feeling a little bit under the weather, actually. But I loved it. I really, really loved it. I can't describe to people, even people who aren't really major gun enthusiasts. You know, I like shooting and I like doing that kind of sport, but I'm not doing it every weekend. Mm-hmm. And I loved it. I thought that third day was so much fun. It was a lot of drills that helped me feel more comfortable with my gun. I took my brand new little Glock 42 with me. And I just had such a great time.
So out of the 4 days, what would you say you brought home? What was the most important thing you brought home from that event?
I felt like this time gave me an opportunity to really skill build. And I took away several things that the instructors were telling me about my grip on the gun. Mm-hmm. I have a tendency to really want to grab onto it. And they did a really good job of helping me with, you know, the isometric tension you're supposed to be putting on the gun, the push, the pull. I also was focusing a little bit more on closing one eye. For some reason, I really like to have both eyes open. And once I started getting those two things down, I started getting a lot more accurate and faster. And it just makes it so much more fun, right? When you're blowing it away. Don't mind the pun.
Yeah, no mind the pun. Well, you know, and then Joe and Mike, you guys were both out there as well. What were your feelings?
Oh, it was great. I always like it when I go out there.
You won a shotgun. We're not talking.
It's the only time it's ever happened.
Yeah, it'll listen to you. Again. Now he's not going again because he won a shotgun.
No, I'm going again. I'll just take a different class.
Oh, I got you.
Well, that's because when you go out with the charity event, they do you know, cool drawings. You get to win cool stuff. And there's a lot more camaraderie. People know know each other from San Diego. But I just think it's you know, there are a lot of programs out there. This is the most affordable. Frontsight is the most affordable, mm-hmm. best mass education of shooters that exists. Mm-hmm. You know, they teach one curriculum, that may or may not be exactly the way you want to do it, but they have taught more people gun safety and proficiency than at any school, I think, in the United States. And they do it, you know, so it's affordable. And I think that's great. And so I look at it as, hey, every year I go out there 2, 3, 4 days of focused practice on fundamentals.
Right.
So I think it's wonderful.
And Laura, you being a new shooter, I would assume that even though you've taken lots of classes, you've got your CCW, I mean, you've done all the work, but it sounds to me like this 4 days was probably one of the best things you could have ever done as a gun owner.
Absolutely. You know, because they start off with the basics, which is, it's nice, right? They always get the fundamentals. But then once you go into some of the drills, it really creates that muscle memory. And that's what I like. I like having that muscle memory. I like having that repetition. I know it seemed grueling at times, but I didn't really feel like it was. I really liked it. I appreciated the instruction. I also just wanted to mention, you know, my mom went out for the second time, and you know, she's 74 and, you know, has a bad knee. And I was so concerned, especially this year, cause she was going for all 4 days, and they just did such a good job of taking care of her too. They helped her modify her gun because she's a lefty, and for some reason the mag release was being pushed every time she pulled it out of the holster. So they sent her up to the armory. They fixed that for her. She didn't have another issue after that.
Oh.
And she and her husband actually stayed longer than Michael and I. Michael and I left on the fourth day after the test. She and her husband stayed behind, and she was bragging about how well she did in the little competition shoots that they did. So they just do such a good job of making everyone comfortable. And that really helped me too, because, you know, I wanted her to have a good experience. And she went last year too. She's a pro. She's gone for 2 years now, but you know, as she gets older and she's not as familiar with the gun, I just felt so comfortable with them. They made it such a good experience for her.
And Laura's not a gun nut. You know, right? This isn't like, you know, you're into it, you're proficient, you have a CCW, you own a firearm, it's fun when we go out, but this is not your main hobby. This isn't a lifestyle you lead. This is, you're pretty run of the mill as far as you know, gun owners out there. You're not like a gun nut, like a fellow gun nut. I don't know. How would you describe it, Laura?
Well, I don't know. I have 8 guns.
It's true, you do have 8 guns.
What?
No, I would say that I really like collecting guns. I like supporting the Second Amendment, the political initiative around it. I love supporting Michael and the organization. I like shooting guns, but I'm not a fanatic about it. You know, I'm not out at the range every weekend. But Frontsight just makes me feel like, golly, maybe I do want to get more into this. Maybe I could be really good at this. You know, it really makes it such a good experience. I would strongly recommend it. Even if people were like, I'm not really into guns, or, you know, I support my husband or I support my spouse and I would, you know, I don't mind going occasionally, I would still say I strongly recommend it. It's such a good experience.
And what caliber was your gun?
Mine's a 380.
And what did everybody tell you?
Oh my gosh. So everybody warned me, make sure you take another gun, take your Glock 19 with you because it's going to hurt your hand and whatever. And I thought, oh no. Okay. Well, I will take the Glock 19. Then come to find out that we brought the Glock 19, but you know, what's his face over here decided that he was going to use it.
I used it.
And
who's what's his face?
But you know what? My little gun performed so beautifully. I was completely fine the whole time. It was just outstanding. I was really, really pleased with it.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Well, I think we got a couple of minutes. Mark is on the line. Hey, Mark.
Yeah. Hey, how you guys doing?
Oh, not bad. We're just talking to Laura. She was telling us about her experience at Frontsight, and I understand you that were there as well.
I was, but first I need to wish Laura a happy birthday. Happy birthday, Laura.
Thank you.
And it was a great time. I was partnered up this year with Joe Germisi.
Hey, I know that.
So I'm kind of working my way through the gun sports radio crowd.
Staff, yeah.
That's right. Bringing the good luck that you always bring.
Well, except for one guy.
Except for one guy, what?
Lance.
That didn't win a gun last year. But did you win a gun again this year?
Me? No, I didn't win a gun this year, okay. But Joe did, and my partner that I was partnered up with last year won a gun,
yeah.
and the year before won a gun. Did you win a gun the year that we were partnered
up
with?
No, I didn't, but I remember you won that big bazooka, whatever the heck that was, last year.
The Ruger Precision Rifle, 6.5 Creedmoor.
All right, buddy. Hey, we got to hit the road. Thank you very much. Sorry we didn't get you on sooner. We'll get you back at another time.
That's okay. Yeah, all right. Have a great day.
I'll talk to you
guys later on.
All right, Laura, you go out and have a great birthday. We'll bring the guy back home to you this afternoon right here. On FM 96.1, AM 1170,
The Answer.
This program is sponsored by Dave Stahl.